Our last speaker before lunch is one of those, it's not an endangered species, but he's a rare one. He's a real data scientist. So welcome Michael Griffin.
Thank you.
Michael?
Thank you all for coming. So I have some really good news for you today. We are very, very lucky people. We are involved in the greatest technology revolution of all time, in all of Earth's history. Intelligent applications are generating vast amounts of wealth, and that wealth generation is only accelerating. In 10, 20, 30 years, the world will be an unimaginably different place. Because I'm not just talking about the generation of monetary wealth. I'm talking about the generation of the kind of wealth that changes the world, that makes the world a better place. That's why we're so lucky. Because every single one of us in this room has the capacity and the tools to change the world. That's pretty cool stuff. And I call this high-impact AI. And it's the practice of developing applications that do two things. One, meet your business goals, so it's grounded in reality, grounded in practicality. But two, try to do something a little bit better. Challenge yourself to do something a little bit more than just meeting your business goals. Do something with those applications to change the world. I'm Michael Griffin, and I am Chief Data Scientist for Insight. And today I'm going to tell you about how we do high-impact AI at Insight, and how you can do it at your companies. And hopefully I'm going to convince you that you actually should do it. So for several years now, we've been doing high-impact AI applications at Insight. We maybe haven't always called them as such, but for example, manufacturing, we've developed applications that lower headcount, improve inventory and capabilities, or improve the way parts flow around complex factory floors, saving companies millions of dollars. And remember, I said this is a two-step process. This is the part of the process that's meeting your business objectives. We've also are in the process right now of developing intelligent applications to improve the effectiveness of our sales and delivery teams by monitoring how they communicate with each other and with clients and suggesting changes. In the coming year, we'll be deploying applications in the healthcare space that promise to save millions, if not billions, of dollars in healthcare expenditures every year. These are all very cool things. Yay for Insight. But these are business goals. These are the kinds of things that I'm very proud to have been a part of, and I'm proud that Insight has accomplished these things and met these business objectives. But maybe we could dig a little deeper. Maybe we could think a little bit more about how these applications could be applied to make the world a better place. So for example, I'll talk about these use cases in a little more detail in a few minutes, but perhaps we could use the same application that we developed to lower headcount and improve inventory and capability to enable our clients to hire differently abled people. People who otherwise would not be qualified to perform these jobs. Perhaps we could develop an application based on our application that's helping our sales and delivery teams to help people build stronger and more meaningful relationships, or to help enrich and individualize the learning experience of millions of students and teachers. And perhaps even with just a simple little different way of thinking, not even an adaptation of this model that we're deploying in the healthcare space next year, but maybe we could help increase the length and quality of millions of lives. That's pretty cool stuff. I think you'll agree that those, the bottom row here kind of qualifies as high impact AI. And these are the kinds of things that we're doing right now. These aren't just aspirations. These are the things that we're doing at Insight right now. And I think that we all can do these things. Before I get into the details of those use cases, I want to talk a little bit about my company, my team, and myself. Insight is a pretty big company. We're a market capitalization of about $3.5 billion. There are about 11,000 people in Insight across 22 different countries. I work in a group of about 1,300 technology consultants. We have deep expertise in all of the subject areas you see up here: cloud enablement, DevOps, data and AI, intelligent edge strategy and design, and development of intelligent apps. I have been a computational and data scientist for over 30 years. I've tried hard not to calculate exactly how many years it is, because it's starting to get to be a very big number. And for the last 6 years, I've been at Insight doing all manner of machine learning applications in just about every market sector you can think of. I started my career doing computational physics. I've done a stint as a bioinformatician developing drug discovery software, and I worked at a quantitative hedge fund for a number of years. And those have all been really fun jobs. I've had a great career, but that's not what motivates me to do high-impact AI. And if you're familiar with Simon Sinek, start with why. My why has to do with the other jobs in my life. My job as a son and a brother and a father and a husband and a foster parent and a mentor and a teacher and a coach and a friend. And it's from these relationships, these people I care about, that I derive the motivation to do high impact AI. And I think if you think about it, that's probably where your motivations lie too. All right, back to our use cases. I've probably given away why this use case is high impact AI, but it doesn't sound all that sexy, right? High impact order fulfillment. Order fulfillment is a company is selling a product. They have people who walk around a warehouse and fill up a cart with that order and then ship it off. That's not the most exciting thing to do in the world. But this was one of the more meaningful projects I've been a part of. It's a manufacturer, distributor. They sell 30,000 different products. They have 9 distribution centers around the country, and they have thousands of orders per day. But more importantly, they have a visionary CTO who's been a very early adopter of AI in this space. And he asked me if we could help him improve the efficiency with which they fill these orders. And I said, yeah, we've been doing that for a while. We can help you eliminate headcount. And he said, no, that's not what I want to do. I want to make it simple enough so that I can hire people with learning disabilities to do this picking, do this order fulfillment. People who have trouble following directions, or maybe given a complex set of directions, they wouldn't be able to do it. And so, and this is where they were starting at. This is a screen capture of an Excel map of their distribution center, one of their distribution centers. And it's hard to see here, but there are hundreds and hundreds of cells here. Each cell represents either a product or an aisle or some of the functional space within that distribution center. And from these Excel maps, they created directions for their pickers. If an order comes in, you go bin A, then bin Z, then and so forth, and pick up products and put them in your cart. And these were, as the crow flies, are physically impossible directions to follow. Directions that are very difficult even for an experienced picker to follow. So he asked us, well, how can I make this simple enough so that someone with a learning disability could be my picker? And so we figured out a way to take these Excel maps, this is just a mock-up of one, and create from them automatically directed graph maps. And as many of you know, directed graphs are very powerful tools, and they can be encoded with lots of different rules. For example, aisles could be one-way, two-way, no U-turns allowed, or we could block off an aisle temporarily while a product is being loaded or unloaded. And then from those directed graphs, we can also construct the shortest path between two points in a map, in a directed graph. And with a little bit of machine learning and optimization magic, we can create the shortest set of paths, the most efficient way to pick up or to fill an order. And again, the next step, obviously, is to construct detailed turn-by-turn directions that could then be deployed in an application to a handheld device, such that in the headset of these pickers, you could be given turn-by-turn directions in the safest possible set of directions and the most efficient set of directions to pick up, to fill your orders. And the visionary CTO I mentioned is also the worst dad joker in the world, and he likes to insert stupid jokes and scores the baseball games while the pickers are in between their picking. But the result is this company had far more efficient picking and easy to follow, in-ear, safe, adaptable directions. And the CTO was able to hire differently abled individuals to fill these orders. And when that project looked like it was going to be a success, he said, well, I have another thing I want my pickers to be able to do. I have 30,000 products. Each of these bins has to be counted or cycle counted or inventoried once every 2 months. It's a very tedious job. My guys hate doing it. They make lots of mistakes. I want to be able to take a photograph of these bins as my pickers are walking around the warehouse, and I want them to be able to inventory, to count these products automatically. He's a very persuasive guy, very passionate, and I'm a sucker for that kind of guy. And I said, yeah, we can do that. And it turns out that's a very hard problem, because not only are these bins often wrapped in plastic like this, but you have to be able to count products that you can't see. You can only see the surfaces of some of these products. Many are hidden. But we figured out a way to do it using some computer vision and an interesting counting algorithm that we developed. And we ended up having a very high accurate application that we were able to deploy to the same handheld devices that the pickers use, and basically upskill them even more such that they could now not only fill orders, but they're conducting inventories at a much higher frequency than had been being conducted before. Instead of once every 2 months with lots of errors, they're conducting inventory, especially in a high volume products, multiple times per day. So a win-win situation for this company. And of course, the cycle counting is driven by auditors, and auditors like more frequent cycle counting. All right, so this next high impact project I mentioned, we are trying to build a product to help our sales and delivery teams improve their effectiveness. And this came out of a project I did with a group of young aspiring data scientists in the company. They just rolled off a project where we volunteered to help some therapists and psychologists quantify anxiety and depression levels in metropolitan areas. And I think they were inspired by that project to do something along the lines of the. And they came to me and they said, we want to do something that's a little more heavily involving data science. The prior project was more of an analytics project. And I said, okay, great. I have one criteria. I want you to come up with it, and I want it to change the world. And they're young people, so they believed me when I said they could do that. And they went back a couple days later and said, we want to develop an application that takes a photograph of a person and predicts their mood. And I said, oh, I never would have thought of that. That's a really interesting idea. So let's do that. But how can we make that applicable to the company? How can we develop something like that and still benefit our company or maybe our clients? And this is right during the middle of the pandemic and the lockdown, and we're always in Teams meetings or Zoom meetings. And I thought, well, what if we did this during a meeting? What if we could analyze the mood of all the participants in a meeting, the people who are sharing their video feed and speaking? And all right, maybe we could use that to help a salesperson evaluate whether or not they're communicating their sales value, their pitch effectively. So they're young, They believed me, then I said we could do this, but it turned out to be a very hard problem as well. There's a lot of information in a video feed. There are images, there's text that's being spoken, and of course there's the vocal intonations of all the people who are speaking. But they were up to the task. They developed 12 different machine learning algorithms to classify various aspects of facial expressions, hand gestures, vocal intonation, and what the people were actually speaking. Developed some ensemble models, deployed that to another application that was able to augment the images in real time, and ended up with images like this, a real-time video augmentation, telling someone viewing this augmented video how everybody was feeling in that application. Maybe that doesn't sound like a great high-impact AI application yet, but every time we meet, we come up with a new way to use this application, and that's what we're going to be exploring later. But at the end of this project, they had a general purpose platform for video augmentation based on what's being communicated and the mood of the participants in the meeting. And I'm going to skip this part. I'm going to tease you with this, but that was a demo of their latest application. They, if you want, I'm teasing you because I want you to come visit me in our booth afterwards, and I'll show you that on my laptop. But every time we meet, we come up with a new way to use this application. In addition to helping our sales and delivery teams become more effective through analyzing communication, they had this great idea of helping people manage their relationships, helping people to build stronger, more meaningful bonds. And another thing that I never would have thought of, and they're all young, they all have teachers. In fact, they're all interns, by the way. This is an application created by 4 interns with very little help from anybody else. They wanted to develop another application that would help teachers evaluate whether or not they're being effective. Are people in the classroom engaged? Are people confused? And so forth. And you can point this the other way and say, all right, how can we help students learn more effectively? How can we help them? Maybe I don't learn the way everybody else learns. Maybe I could construct in real time an individualized learning plan for me. As I'm hearing what the teacher is saying, this application is developing an alternative lesson plan, customized to the way I learn. And this list goes on and on and on. I think we have upwards of 20 different applications that we've thought of that we might be able to develop. And it turns out that the interns also learned a little bit about machine learning bias. Every time I come up in one of their videos, I'm either angry or confused. One other thing, though, this is not explicitly called out as a use case, but it occurred to me while I was making the slide that a fourth possible use case here is hire interns. Why not hire 4 interns who don't look like you, who don't share your background, and tell them their one and only job is to use machine learning to change the world, and then stand back and stay out of the way and see what happens. Maybe you'll get as lucky as I did. All right, last use case. Easily the most impactful thing I've done in my career. I've been around a long time. This is in the healthcare space. It concerns improving the way hypertension patients are treated. 100 million US adults have hypertension. It costs an estimated $200 billion per year in additional healthcare costs because of for people with hypertension, and contributes to over 400,000 deaths per year. And it's a crazy complicated thing to treat. Over 70 medications from 9 different medication classes have been approved to treat hypertension. And if you can do the math in your head, the number of degrees of freedom there is astronomical. And a hospital system out in the Midwest asked us to help them streamline this process, help their clinicians, provide clinical decision support to help them treat hypertensive patients more efficiently. They have 400,000 patients diagnosed with hypertension between 2016 and 2020, and astoundingly, they have prescribed to those 400,000 patients 10,000 different combinations of medications to treat hypertension. Moreover, each of those medications can be prescribed at different dosages, and if you do the math, they've prescribed over 200,000 different combinations of medications and dosages to their 400,000 hypertension patients. So in effect, they're practicing individualized medicine without the help of analytics, just based on FDA guidelines and their experience. And the result is that only 40% of those patients have their hypertension controlled. These are patients who have been diagnosed and have been treated for at least a year by the hospital. They've only 40% have had their hypertension controlled. So using pretty standard techniques for data engineering, feature engineering, and machine learning, plus a little bit of optimization magic, we were able to construct what amounts to a recommendation engine for their clinicians that instead of an astronomical number of combinations, we are able to give them three or four or five combinations that of medications and dosages that are most likely to control an individual patient's hypertension. And the end result is that if our predictions hold true, and you never know until you actually do this in the wild, if our predictions hold true, then we will control an additional 16% of that patient population. It may not sound like a lot, but if 16% of 400,000 people is a pretty big number. And it can lead to the savings of over $130 million per year and reduced healthcare costs. But the high impact side of this is that because people with hypertension tend to live longer, this application may add an additional 18,000 years to this patient population's total life. That's a lot. And if you scale that up to the 100 million people in the United States or the billion people in the world who have hypertension, that's pretty pretty staggering number. All right, so enough for the use cases. As I mentioned, high impact AI, probably some of you are doing this already. And I know for sure that people in this conference are. Two simple steps. One, meet your business objectives. Develop an intelligent application that meets your business objectives. And two, use your imagination. This sounds kind of, maybe I didn't put a lot of thought into this slide, but it really is a mindset. It's a choice. Can you develop applications to meet your business objectives? Yes. But can you put a little more thought into it and figure out how you can use that same application or an extension of that application to make the world a better place? Why would your company want to do this? Well, everybody talks about having meaningful jobs. There's a lot of press about how millennials want meaning in their jobs. Well, I want meaning in my job too. And I know that everybody in this room does. Everybody in this building does. So why not do things that are meaningful? That seems like a no-brainer. You track talent, you keep talent, and it's fun. So, in summary, high-impact AI helps you attract and retain the best talent in the world. It also helps you attract some really cool clients. There are a lot of really interesting. I'm a consultant, and I work with a lot of different companies. Some companies are more focused on the high-impact side than others, and those are my favorite clients. Not a lot of risk. You meet your business objectives, therefore you eliminate risk in that regard. You try to do a little extra, there's some risk there for sure. But the payoff can be very, very high. So in the end, you can make money and you can make your family proud. And maybe, you know, you can even help your mom live longer. How cool is that? All right. And so finally, thank you very much. And please feel free to visit. I'll be in booth 307. It's right out the door, outside the door here.
We have questions for Mike? Anyone?
I do. I have something for you, Mike. So I've got an idea for the mood ring.
Okay.
So
Here's what's going on. If you follow
that's
these,
one of the developers.
You're one of them.
Right.
Perfect.
There. Yeah.
So, one of the biggest challenges you talk about AI challenges. One is natural language understanding, right?
Mm-hmm.
One of the things you hit on that was really interesting is when you try to combine different inputs, like it's text, speech, vision. Those things make your confidence levels go up as to what that person is thinking or saying.
Yes.
Makes sense? Because mm-hmm. as humans, we don't do all these by single channel. Biggest problem with that is customer service. So what if you were able to build these more intelligent chatbots or virtual agents that incorporated the visual aspect? So now you're seeing visual cues. There are some people that work on this a little bit. It's
mm-hmm.
difficult because you'd have to talk everybody into doing a FaceTime with you instead of talking on the phone or texting you or whatever. But that's the idea
yep.
because those confidence levels go up way high. And the problem with virtual assistants in general and customer service is they don't understand what you're saying or what your mood is or where you're going with things. So
yes.
there's one for you to think about. Like
That's an excellent point. And it's been, I don't know how concrete these numbers are, but it's been said that only 5% of the information that's conveyed in a face-to-face conversation is the text that's being spoken.
Right.
The rest is vocal intonation and body posture, hand gestures, eye movements, facial expressions, all those things.
And yet we all do none of that anymore. We're here, but none of us do that. The other one that's just like that is cars. So, you know, as we move into autonomous cars, we've heard from our research is that car manufacturers are, you know, changing into software companies. Some of them are already talking about it today. So they're looking at what you're doing in the car and want to interact with how understanding what you're thinking and wanting to do. So there's this idea of how the car interacts with you or can anticipate things is interesting.
Yeah.
There's a lot of work being done there.
Are you a distracted driver?
Very good. Anybody else? No? Mike, thank you.
Appreciate
it. Very interesting
thank
stuff.
You.